Today, I'm going to go through how to lay out an off-grid 12-volt system in your vehicle that basically means you can live out of it full-time and rely on it in any situation. Now, this is just a start, and there are plenty of other products, designs, and methods out there that you could use to build on this. But as a good value setup, this will allow you to run heaps of 12-volt at camp, including your fridge. Plus, you'll be able to run and charge your power tools and even more power-hungry devices like a coffee machine or even a microwave. Now, this is Breno's D-Max, which means it's used almost every week for a trip, and he'll use it almost every weekend. That means it needs to be reliable, easy to use, low maintenance, and able to put out a fair whack of power almost every day. So if you want to build a system that allows you to get off-road and off-grid for extended periods of time in any situation, then listen up. I'm going to show you how easy it is to build a robust 12-volt system that's modular enough to easily upgrade as you go. Now, the first thing you'll need is a deep cycle battery. This is the heart of your 12-volt system and allows you to store and use your power. Now, in this setup, we've opted for a 138 amp hour battery in a battery box, which makes it really easy to use that power thanks to all the terminals, plugs, and connectors. Plus, you can keep an eye on your battery voltage really easily. Now, with your deep cycle battery, number one, you want to keep it as low as possible in your vehicle because they can be quite heavy and you don't want it to negatively affect your center of gravity. Two, you want to keep them as stable a temperature as possible, and particularly you don't want them getting too hot as that can ruin your battery over time. And third, you want to buy a larger capacity battery than you think you'll actually need. Remember, with an AGM deep cycle battery, you only want to use about 50% of its capacity. So if you're running a 100 amp hour battery, you've got about 50 amp hours to play with. And just as a basic example, if your fridge on average draws 1 amp hour and you've got 50 usable amp hours, you could run your fridge for around 50 hours. But if you're aiming to run something that uses 10 amp hours, then you could only run it for 5 hours. For a more detailed explanation, I've put a link in the description of a video where I go through all of that in really high detail. So if you're interested, check that out. Now, once you've got that second battery in your vehicle, it's going to allow you to run all your 12-volt accessories, camping gear, camp lights, and a fridge while you're sitting at camp. And in this setup, what we've used is not only a battery box, but also one of these pre-made and pre-wired 12-volt control boxes. That means you've already got fused power, plenty of switches and outlets, so you can run all your gear really easily. Now, there's three easy ways to ensure that the system is robust enough to handle heaps of 12-volt gear or plenty of power-hungry gear. The first one is to make sure that your power cables are a big enough diameter, and there's a link in the description with some basics on that. Second, you can make your own power distribution box or setup, but ensure that you're using fuses or circuit breakers as close as possible to the battery so that if anything does go wrong, they'll pop instead of a short. And third, if you are planning to use a lot of power-hungry accessories, then a good investment is to run 2 deep cycle batteries. That means you'll have double usable capacity, plenty of storage, and plenty of power to go around. So now that you've got your second battery in the vehicle, and you've got plenty of 12-volt accessories that you want to run off it, you need a way to keep your battery charged and topped up. Now, you could use a dual battery system and a separate solar regulator to do this, which would allow you to charge while you're moving and while you're at camp. But for a rugged, robust, and really bush-proof setup that's ready for anything, I'd recommend a DC-DC charger with solar input. Now, while your vehicle is running, a DC-DC charger takes the alternator output from under the bonnet to really efficiently and effectively charge your deep cycle battery in the back of your vehicle. And there's more info in the description and a link to another video on that. Now, in this setup, the DC-DC charger that we run has solar priority charging, which means we can fit a permanent solar panel to the setup here, and it will use that power first before using the alternator charge. That means you're charging even if you're sitting at the shops. While you're driving down the road, it's using your solar power first, and while you're sitting at camp, it's constantly charging your batteries. So the three tips for a robust charging system: first one is to ideally use a DC-DC charger, and then ideally use one that has solar priority charging. Number two is to make use of that solar charging by fitting a permanent solar panel so that your battery's being charged as long as you're in the sun. And number three is to look for a DC-DC charger that's able to charge your battery type. This is an AGM battery and needs a higher charging voltage. So that DC-DC charger has selectable charging profiles to make sure you're getting the most out of the battery. With the DC-DC charger, we know we can rely on the battery to be charged efficiently and effectively. So long as the sun's been out on your permanent solar, or you've been driving for a couple of hours, you can pretty much guarantee that your battery is fully charged. Now that's good because it means you can start to think about running some more power-hungry devices or some luxuries from home. And the way to do that is with an inverter. Now an inverter takes the 12-volt DC from your battery, ups the voltage and converts it into AC, just like your power points at home. Now in this setup, we're running a pure sine wave inverter because it closely matches what you'd expect to get out of your power point at home. And that means it'll run sensitive electronics and power tools and things like that without an issue. There are other types on the market, square wave and modified square wave, and they can cause issues running sensitive electronics or tools. So a couple of tips to ensure that your inverter system is up to scratch if you want to rely on it. Number one is that inverters come in a wide range of sizes and they actually work most efficiently when they're nearly at full capacity. So if you're only planning to run a couple of 100 watts or 1,000 watts, you don't need a 5,000 watt inverter. Number two is that some appliances or tools require a larger startup current before they settle down. So if you want to run power tools, microwaves or coffee machines, you might need a slightly larger inverter to get it going. Then it's fine once it settles down. So don't buy an inverter that's right on the limit. You've got to find that balance. And number three, I've said it before, you've got to consider how much power you're drawing from your battery instantaneously and how much capacity you're drawing. So if you wanted to run a 1500 watt microwave off this inverter, it'd be drawing 125 amps. But if you're only using the inverter for 3 minutes, it means that you've only drawn 6.25 amp hours out of your battery. If you are planning to run really power hungry devices a lot, it's a good idea to get two batteries to share that power output. Now, a microwave might seem like a bit of a luxury that you'd never use, but if you do have a trailer or a caravan and you've got the space, they can come in handy. Plus, we've used these on a bunch of trips when we've vacuum sealed food and we just need a quick reheated meal. There you go, 90 seconds. It's drawing very little capacity from your battery. So long as you can charge it back up, it's awesome. Once you start running those more power hungry devices like microwaves, coffee machines, or power tools, you need to think about increasing your charging capacity as well. Now, the first way you could do that is by adding more permanent solar to your vehicle. This DC-DC charger is capable of accepting about 360 watts of solar input. That means for every hour of decent sun, you can charge your battery about 25 amps. Number two is that you should add a portable solar panel to your setup. And I always say this, it's because it's super easy to fit into your vehicle when you're going on an extended trip, and they're super simple to set up when you're at camp to get more power into your system. Now keep in mind, you can run your permanent and your portable solar panels into the same regulator, but you'll need to check the voltage at Pmax specification on both panels, because once you combine them, the system will use the lower voltage, so it could negatively affect your output. Now what we've done on this setup is we've got a DC-DC charger with our permanent solar input, plus we've added a second MPPT regulator with a solar input down here, so we can plug portable solar straight in. Now that means each panel is working independently, it's using its full potential and charging your battery most effectively. Now the third option, and it's a great idea, is to add a 240 volt charger into your setup. Plug your system in and make sure your battery's got a really good charge. And if you're heading more remote, the other option, you can run a generator throughout the day, plug it into your 240 volt charger and you know your battery's getting a good charge. Now a hot tip if you're doing that, use your generator or the powered site to run your fridge as well. Batteries prefer to be charged when they're not running any appliances. A generator also gives you that option of running your power-hungry devices or appliances directly off 240 volt here, rather than using your inverter and using your battery capacity. So if you are really off-grid and really remote, it's a good option. So now you've got a complete setup that's ready for any situation. At its heart is your deep cycle battery. By setting up some sort of power distribution, whether it's a battery box or 12 volt control box, it means you can run all your 12 volt gear, your camp lights, and your fridge. Of course, that means you need some way to keep your battery charged up. The best way to do that is with a DC-DC charger with solar priority charging. So it'll charge from your alternator while you're driving, but it always prioritizes that free solar power. Once you can rely on your system to be charged and topped up all the time, it means you can start to run those more power-hungry devices. That means an inverter, so you can run your tools, microwaves and coffee machines, and your sensitive electronics like laptops. Finally, if you want to run those more powerful accessories, you're going to need extra methods of charging. Number one is to add more permanent solar. Number two, add a portable solar panel to your setup. You can use the included regulator or hard mount a second regulator for better efficiency. Finally, add a 240 volt charger, which means you can easily plug in when you're next to the powered site. And if you're off grid, you can use your generator to effectively charge your battery. Hopefully this has given you a really good understanding of how to lay out or set up a really robust and reliable off-grid 12 volt system. As I said earlier, this is completely modular. You can always upgrade your 12 volt and add more circuits. You can put a bigger battery bank in, or even a bigger generator or more solar panels as you expand. If you want any more technical information, make sure you check out those video links that I've put in the description, or just have a browse of the channel, as there's plenty more 12 volt tips, tricks, and install videos too. Otherwise, if you're into anything camping and four-wheel driving, it's worth a look. Cheers, guys.